We've all heard about Ted Bundy. We've all seen the face of Jeffrey Dahmer. And most of us have seen the likes of the BTK killer. What these people have in common lies in a single personality trait. Allegedly, they were psychopaths. A psychopath is a term used to describe an individual who displays a set of specific personality traits and behaviors associated with a psychological condition called psychopathy. Psychopathy is considered a subset of an antisocial personality disorder, usually characterized by a lack of empathy, remorse, and conscience, as well as a tendency to engage in manipulative and often criminal behavior. However, it is worth mentioning that not all individuals with psychopathic traits become criminals or engage in violent behavior. Although psychopathy is often associated with an increased risk of criminality and poses challenges in forming and maintaining healthy relationships due to the lack of empathy and manipulative tendencies, they allegedly displayed them all. However, psychotic tendencies aren't limited to only these three. As of the release of this video, the most infamous five are Ted Bundy, John Wayne Gacy, Jeffrey Dahmer, Aileen Wuornos, and Gary Ridgway. But we meet today not for these five, but a somewhat secretive sixth that brought a multitude of states to their knees, trembling in fear. All a result of his heinous actions and his apparent allegiance to the devil. Welcome back, fellow mystery seekers, to another informative episode of Forgotten Mysteries. Today we take a look at a serial killer not widely discussed. While he has his fair share of gruesome acts, he's somewhat undermined within the spotlight of popular media. His name, if Richard Ramirez, the man whose actions caused three states to enter temporary lockdown until he was captured. Today, we look at the American Night Stalker. If you like this type of content, be sure to like and subscribe as we're slowly approaching another milestone. Without further delay, let's take a look at today's mystery. Richard Ramirez was born on February 29, 1960, in El Paso, Texas, to Mexican-American parents. He was the youngest of five siblings. Ramirez had a troubled upbringing marked by various influences and experiences that may have contributed to his later criminal behavior. As a child, Ramirez sustained several head injuries, including one incident in which he was knocked unconscious by a swing set. Some experts believe that these head injuries, combined with other factors, might have contributed to his violent tendencies later in life. Ramirez was exposed to the darker aspects of life from an early age. His father was reportedly physically abusive, and Ramirez idolized his cousin, Miguel Mike Ramirez, who had served in the Vietnam War and shared graphic war stories and photographs with him, including images of torturing and killing Vietnamese women. Additionally, Ramirez's older cousin Mike introduced him to drugs and criminal activities, exposing him to a deviant lifestyle. By his teenage years, Ramirez was engaging in petty theft and drug abuse, which further contributed to his delinquency. In 1977, at the age of 17, Ramirez moved to California, settling in Los Angeles. There, he continued to involve himself in criminal activities, including burglaries and drug use. Over time, his behavior escalated, leading him to commit more violent and heinous crimes. Understanding Ramirez's early life provides some insight into the factors that may have shaped his criminal behavior. However, it is important to note that numerous individuals who experience difficult childhoods or traumatic events do not go on to commit violent crimes. The complex interplay of various influences and psychological factors can contribute to an individual's path toward criminality. There is limited information available about Richard Ramirez's specific experiences during his school life. However, some general details about his education have been reported. During his early years, Ramirez attended public schools in El Paso, Texas. It is not widely documented whether he faced significant challenges or exhibited behavioral issues during his time in school. However, there are reports that he was a quiet and reserved student. As Ramirez grew older and moved to California, his school life became less stable. He dropped out of Jefferson High School in Los Angeles and did not complete his formal education. Instead, he became involved in a criminal lifestyle, engaging in drug use and petty theft. It is important to note that the details of Ramirez's school life are relatively scarce, and it is challenging to draw definitive conclusions about how his experiences in school may have influenced his later criminal behavior.
1985, the hottest summer in 100 years gripped Los Angeles. Like a demon born from the scorching winds, a serial killer was on the prowl. Before he was captured, more than a dozen people would die. for no other reason than that they crossed paths with Richard Ramirez, the Night Stalker.
Los Angeles police today added more killings to those already linked with the murderer called the Night Stalker.
Patrols and warned residents to lock their doors and windows and increase indoor lighting.
Let's get everyone mobilized together in self-defense in this valley. Who wants to be next? I don't. No one else does.
With his final vicious assault on a Mission Viejo couple, Ramirez escaped in a stolen car. The vehicle was recovered, complete with a clear set of fingerprints, which police traced to Ramirez, whom they knew as a 25-year-old drifter with a lengthy history of traffic and drug arrest. An all-points bulletin was issued for Ramirez on August 30th, his mugshot broadcast on television, and he was captured by civilians in East Los Angeles the following day, mobbed and beaten as he tried to steal a car.
An officer takes Richard Ramirez into custody.
And he saved Richard's life because they were going to do him. They were going to toast him.
His head bandaged from the beating he had received, Ramirez was moved to the county jail, protected by 50 armed officers. On arrival in his holding cell, he seemed anxious to confess. "I want the electric chair," he said. "They should have shot me in the street." Over the next few weeks, there were many opportunities for the press to film the Night Stalker as he was brought from prison to be questioned. He confessed to investigators, "I love to kill people. I love to watch them die. I love all that blood." The gaunt, black-clad figure claimed to have committed 20 murders. He was eventually charged with 14 counts of murder, 5 of attempted murder, 2 of kidnapping, 7 of rape, 19 of burglary, 6 of robbery, and 15 charges of sexual assault. His arrest was a personal triumph for Detective Sergeant Salerno, who had brought together the task force and led the hunt.
Various factors, including his troubled family background, exposure to violence, and drug use, likely played a more significant role in shaping his path toward criminality. Before he embarked on his major crime spree, he engaged in a series of petty crimes and delinquent behavior. These early criminal activities contributed to his deviant lifestyle and may have foreshadowed his later violent crimes. During his teenage years, Ramirez began committing burglaries and thefts. He would break into homes, steal valuables, and sell them to fund his drug habits. He also developed a preference for breaking into homes during the nighttime while the occupants were asleep, a pattern that would later become a significant feature of his modus operandi as the Night Stalker. Ramirez's early criminal behavior also included involvement in drug use and sales. He became addicted to drugs, particularly cocaine and LSD, which further fueled his erratic behavior and contributed to his downward spiral. It is important to note that these early criminal activities were precursors to the more extreme and violent crimes he would commit later. They provided him with a sense of thrill and satisfaction, which eventually escalated into a desire for more power and control over his victims. Ramirez's early life of petty crimes highlights the progression of his criminal behavior and the deepening of his antisocial tendencies. These activities likely laid the groundwork for his later transformation into a brutal serial killer. Richard Ramirez's first major crime was committed on April 10, 1984. He broke into the home of 79-year-old Jenny Vincow in Glassell Park, Los Angeles. Ramirez entered the residence through an unlocked window while Vincow was sleeping. He proceeded to sexually assault her and then stabbed her multiple times, killing her. Ramirez also mutilated Vincow's body by gouging out her eyes with a knife. Following this brutal murder, Ramirez continued his spree of violence and terror throughout the Los Angeles area. His crimes involved home invasion, sexual assault, robbery, and murder. Ramirez often targeted vulnerable victims, such as elderly individuals or those living alone. He would gain access to their homes through unlocked windows or doors, surprising them in their sleep. Some of the notable crimes committed by Ramirez include: June 28, 1984. Ramirez attacked Dale Okazaki, a 34-year-old woman, in her home in Sierra Madre. He beat her with a tire iron and attempted to strangle her, but she fought back and escaped with injuries. March 17, 1985. Ramirez broke into the home of Maria Hernandez in Rosemead. He shot her in the face, but she survived due to the bullet deflecting off her keys in her hand. March 27, 1985. Ramirez attacked Vincent Zazara, 64, and his wife Maxine Zazara, 44, in their Whittier home. He shot Vincent in the head, killing him instantly, and sexually assaulted and beat Maxine before attempting to suffocate her with a pillow. She managed to escape. May 14, 1985. Ramirez murdered William Doy, 66, and his wife Lillian Doy, 56, in their Monterey Park home. He beat and killed them, leaving behind satanic symbols at the crime scene. May 29, 1985. Ramirez broke into the home of Mabel Bell, 83, and her disabled sister, Florence Lang, 81, in Monrovia. He bludgeoned both women with a hammer, killing Bell and severely injuring Lang. These are just a few examples of the horrific crimes committed by Richard Ramirez during his crime spree. His acts of violence, combined with his eerie appearance and the mysterious nature of the attacks, created widespread fear and panic in the three states. The investigation into Richard Ramirez's crimes was a complex and challenging process that involved multiple law enforcement agencies and a dedicated task force. Due to the widespread fear and panic caused by his crimes, the investigation garnered significant attention and resources. The Los Angeles Police Department took the lead in the investigation, working in collaboration with other law enforcement agencies, including the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department and the California Highway Patrol. They formed a special task force called the Night Stalker Task Force to focus on capturing Ramirez. The investigation primarily relied on evidence collected from crime scenes, witness testimonies, and forensic analysis. The authorities meticulously combed through the physical evidence, such as fingerprints and DNA, in an attempt to link the crimes to a single perpetrator. The media played a significant role in spreading information about Ramirez and his crimes. The extensive media coverage generated numerous tips and leads from the public, contributing to the investigation. Police released sketches and descriptions of Ramirez, urging the public to be vigilant and report any relevant information. One crucial breakthrough in the investigation occurred when Ramirez's stolen car, a Toyota station wagon, was found abandoned in Los Angeles. The vehicle yielded valuable evidence, including a fingerprint that matched Ramirez's criminal record. Richard Ramirez's arrest occurred on August 31, 1985, in East Los Angeles, California. It followed a series of events that led to his identification and subsequent apprehension. On the evening of August 30, 1985, Ramirez's mugshot and details were shown on the television show A Current Affair. The broadcast prompted several people to recognize him while he was walking in the neighborhood of East Los Angeles the next day. A group of residents, led by a woman named Maria Hernandez, confronted Ramirez and recognized him as the Night Stalker due to his distinctive appearance and the widely circulated sketches. Realizing he had been identified, Ramirez attempted to flee the scene. The residents chased after him, shouting for help and notifying the police. Ramirez attempted to carjack two vehicles during his escape but was unsuccessful. Eventually, the residents caught up with him and managed to subdue him until the police arrived. When the police arrived at the scene, they confirmed the identity of the suspect as Richard Ramirez, the notorious Night Stalker. He was taken into custody and arrested without further incident. Ramirez's arrest brought relief and closure to the community that had been terrorized by his violent crimes for months. News of his capture spread quickly, and people celebrated the end of the Night Stalker's reign of terror. Richard Ramirez's trial was a high-profile case that captured significant media attention and public interest. The legal proceedings aimed to hold Ramirez accountable for his crimes and determine his guilt or innocence. Ramirez's trial began on July 22, 1988, at the Clara Shortridge Fultz Criminal Justice Center in downtown Los Angeles. He faced 13 counts of murder, 5 counts of attempted murder, 11 counts of sexual assault, and 14 counts of burglary, among other charges.
It was the most difficult case I've worked.
Why is that?
It's the most complex.
I was relieved because I knew citizens were safe, and we had the right guy. And I knew my family would be coming back home. So it's a good day.
With so many crimes to consider, it took 2 years just to bring Ramirez to the preliminary hearing on the 6th of March, 1987. Then legal delays spun the process out by another 2 years. In that time, from his cell at San Quentin, he made a full confession, then retracted it, and constantly changed his mind about who he wanted to represent him. But this was not allowed to delay Ramirez's first public appearance at his arraignment. Hiding behind his attorneys, he gave an ambiguous reply when asked to plead.
Will you give up your right to enter your plea today?
Yes.
And you waive and give up your right to be taken to a preliminary hearing within 10 days of today?
Yes.
Ramirez would be charged with 13 murders and 40 other counts of sodomy, rape, and assault. He chose as his lawyers two young and inexperienced attorneys, Arturo and Daniel Hernandez.
We ready to enter a plea of not guilty.
They had never before tried a murder case. The Hernandezes would delay the trial for years with pretrial motions and repeated requests for postponement. Ramirez took the opportunity to work on his persona, alternately sitting sullenly, flashing satanic symbols, or simply seething at the world. He had finally achieved the fame he dreamed of as a child. But the delays could not last forever. In January of 1989, Richard Ramirez would finally face a jury that would determine if he was indeed the Night Stalker. After years of delay, the man who held Los Angeles in terror for months finally faces a jury.
In the course of his 1989 trial for multiple murder, the haughty looks and bad attitude of serial killer Richard Ramirez inspired a startling new brand of cult appeal among many of the nation's disaffected youth. Playing his perverse role of a rock star-styled rebel to the hilt, Ramirez even cultivated a devoted female fan following. In jail, he told a fellow inmate, "I've killed 20 people, man. I love all that blood."
And he would sit there, you know, just staring everybody down, and you couldn't help but feel uneasy.
The prosecution is led by Philip Halpin. Charge by charge, and week after week, Halpin details the gruesome evidence of rape and torture, shooting and stabbing.
You had horrible things, eye gougings and terrible stabbings and people being terrified in their homes. And yet, there were these young women who came to court and were Richard Ramirez groupies. They thought he was cute. They thought that he was handsome. They were, I suppose, mesmerized by the whole mystique.
I'll never forget the photographs that I saw. They were very graphic, very violent. Things that you just hear about or you see maybe in a movie.
While Prosecutor Halpin continues to methodically present his case, Arturo and Daniel Hernandez do little in their cross-examination to knock it down.
They had their hearts in it, but they did not know enough about legal procedure to really put on a good defense. And I think they may have also been hampered by their client, who was not particularly interested in putting on a good defense and did not assist them greatly. He seemed detached from the whole thing. Occasionally he would have an outburst. And when he had an outburst, it was big headlines.
I won't come back in here again. You understand that? This trial is a joke.
He did have a way with words.
Because
the defense team shows signs of strain.
The trial garnered extensive media coverage due to the shocking nature of the crimes, Ramirez's chilling appearance, and the fear he instilled in the community. The courtroom was filled with spectators, reporters, and families of the victims, adding to the intense atmosphere surrounding the proceedings. Throughout the trial, the prosecution presented a wealth of evidence, including fingerprints, DNA, eyewitness testimonies, and recovered stolen property, linking Ramirez to the crimes. They sought to establish a pattern of behavior and demonstrate that Ramirez was responsible for the brutal acts committed during the Night Stalker crime spree. Ramirez's defense team, led by attorney Daniel Hernandez, attempted to challenge the prosecution's evidence and create doubt about Ramirez's guilt. They argued that the evidence had been mishandled and suggested the possibility of multiple perpetrators involved in the crimes. Despite the defense's efforts, the overwhelming evidence against Ramirez, including a fingerprint matching his criminal record found at a crime scene, proved challenging to overcome. Additionally, Ramirez's own statements and his capture by vigilant citizens further solidified the prosecution's case. On September 20, 1989, after weeks of deliberation, the jury found Richard Ramirez guilty on all charges. The trial then entered the penalty phase, where the jury determined whether Ramirez should be sentenced to death or life imprisonment. The defense presented arguments for mitigation, emphasizing Ramirez's troubled upbringing, drug use, and potential mental health issues. Ultimately, on November 7, 1989, the jury recommended the death penalty for Ramirez. The judge honored the jury's recommendation and sentenced him to death for each of the 13 murder convictions. Ramirez remained on death row at San Quentin State Prison until his death in 2013. Richard Ramirez's trial was significant, not only due to the heinous nature of his crimes, but also because it underscored the impact of serial killers on society and the pursuit of justice for their victims. Following his arrest, Richard Ramirez was charged with numerous crimes, including murder, sexual assault, burglary, and attempted murder. The subsequent trial and legal proceedings resulted in his conviction and multiple death sentences. Ramirez spent years on death row before he died of complications from B-cell lymphoma on June 7, 2013, while still awaiting execution.
Arturo complains of health problems and asks for a recess. Some days, Daniel doesn't come to court at all. Judge Michael Tynan orders them both back into court.
Testimony is going to show once.
In May, the defense begins to present its case. The Hernandezes, realizing they need help, enlist Ray Clark, a more experienced defense attorney.
Who do you defend if you don't defend him? I mean, if you don't defend Richard Ramirez, who? It's the worst among us who needs the best defense.
Clark re-energizes the defense team. He tries to raise doubts about the prosecution case and builds his own.
Our defense strategy had to be alibi. That's the only way that you could win. You couldn't say, I was in this lady's apartment, but I didn't shoot her husband, or I didn't blah, blah, blah. You have to say, I wasn't there. Some other dude did it.
But the strategy doesn't hold up.
It seemed like we had some alibis which didn't pan out very well. His father, I believe, was one, an alibi, and I think they blew us out of the water on that. But no, we didn't have great alibi witnesses.
Finally, on July 26th, the case goes to the jury. On September 20th, the jury reaches its unanimous decision.
We, the jury, in the above-entitled action, having found the defendant, Richard Ramirez, guilty of the murder of Jenny Vinco.
It is the same for every charge. Now the trial enters the penalty phase, and it is up to the Hernandezes to try to keep their client off death row.
They really presented very little of what you usually have to try to save a defendant, psychological profile, background on what made him the way he was. One of the lawyers actually argued that Richard Ramirez might be the devil, and if so, the devil deserves sympathy too.
With little mitigating evidence, the jury has no choice in its recommendation to Judge Tynan.
It is the judgment and sentence of this court that Richard Ramirez shall suffer the death penalty. This penalty is to be inflicted within the walls of the state prison of San Quentin, California.
On November 7th, 1989, Richard Ramirez is sentenced to die in the gas chamber 19 times. But first, he addresses the court.
Before, and the fact remains that what is, you don't understand me, you are not expected to, you are not capable of it. I am beyond your experience. I am beyond good and evil. Legions of the night, Nightbreed, repeat not the errors of Nightfather and show no mercy. I will be avenged. Lucifer dwells within us all.
As Richard Ramirez is led to prison on that November day, he has one final comment for the media.
Big deal. Death always went with the territories. I'll see you in Disneyland.
Instead, Richard Ramirez went to San Quentin Prison. His strange story continues. 10 years after his sentencing, he is very much alive, though he is confined to death row at San Quentin Prison.
I know people aren't going to want to hear it and might make some people angry, but he's got some nice ways about him. He's got like this small town boy, this small town boy quality, and he's kind of wide-eyed about everything.
Ramirez's strange charisma persists to this day. He continues to receive mail from around the world, and there are any number of sites dedicated to him on the internet. One of those who befriended Ramirez is juror Cynthia Hayden.
I sought out Rich to get the answers to my questions. Now, first of all, I wanted to know what everybody else wanted to know, why? Why did you do this? How could you do this? He said he does it because he likes it. He likes doing it. He enjoys it.
Hayden has spent many hours with Ramirez.
He's really opened my eyes to the darker side of the world, and that there are people out there who are capable of these things, who like to do these things, and they're ordinary-looking citizens.
Once he was an innocent child, buffeted by a brutal environment. Later, he was a feared killer, ruled by Satan. Now, he is fated to finish his days under lock and key. And on October 3rd, 1996, Richard Ramirez became a husband to a woman who first began writing to him during his trial 11 years earlier.
I just want to say I'm ecstatically happy today and very, very proud to have married Richard and to be his wife. And I hope that you will be very respectful of the day and let me go and enjoy my day in peace.
It was a standard kind of ceremony, except that they don't say until death do you part on death row.
Richard Ramirez is still years away from facing his sentence as the appeals process grinds its way through the courts. His lawyers refuse to talk to court TV, but speculation is that it may be based on an incompetent defense during his trial or the lack of mitigating evidence presented during the penalty phase.
I've heard it said before by other jurors that had they known what we later found out about him, maybe they wouldn't have voted for the death penalty.
Seems unlikely that they would overturn the decision at this point. But then appeals courts have done things before that we don't expect, so who knows?
Richard Ramirez rarely speaks to the media, but he has spoken on tape to writer Philip Carlo.
And serial killers and most killers in general have a dead conscience. Normal, ordinary people do not think like a serial killer. They have no conception of what is going through a killer's mind, how he operates. I think there is a divine force that is out there. I believe also there's a malevolent force that is out there. Then again, they could be one and the same. Death is death, and it is said that no man knows his own death. Sure, for a few minutes you might feel it. I've really not given much thought to that.
For those who know Richard Ramirez, the possibility of his ever walking the streets again is frightening.
I think he would do exactly what he did before. Like, you have a job, I have a job, he has a job. His job is killing people. That's what he was trained to do.
For those who have seen the worst of the Night Stalker, there is only one way to end this story.
My plan is to live long enough to see Richard Ramirez executed. And I plan to be there personally.
Thank you for joining us on this journey through the disturbing life and crimes of Richard Ramirez, better known as the Night Stalker. We have explored the chilling details of his major crimes, the investigation that led to his capture, and the subsequent trial that sought justice for his victims. Learning about the dark and twisted actions of individuals like Ramirez can be both captivating and unsettling. It is a reminder of the importance of understanding the complexities of human behavior and the devastating impact it can have on innocent lives. If you found this exploration into true crime intriguing, we invite you to continue your quest for knowledge and join us on future investigations. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel and turn on notifications so you never miss an opportunity to delve into the mysteries that lie beneath the surface. We value your engagement and encourage you to share your thoughts, reflections, and suggestions in the comments section below. Together, we can foster a respectful and enlightening community that seeks truth and understanding. Thank you for being a part of this journey, and we look forward to embarking on more thought-provoking explorations of true crime and the human psyche. Stay curious, stay vigilant, and remember the victims whose stories deserve to be heard. Subscribe.